my computers of my collection. This is a 386 DX40 that I put together. It's in an original IBM AT case that's missing the top cover. The case I found at same warehouse that I pick up a lot of my electronic junk and parts and whatnot. The case, though, didn't have the original AT parts, because the original AT was a 286. Somebody had put a, 386 motherboard and, the 386 parts from that era. I can't remember. I think it was missing the drives. But anyway, the reason the cover's missing is the battery that was in there had leaked acid, and the case was sitting on its side, and the acid not only destroyed the motherboard and the video card, but it actually ate out the whole side of the case. So, pretty much all it was left was just the main chassis part, but no cover. So I just kind of used it like as a bench PC for testing, vintage hard drives and stuff like that, because it was, with its open access, it was easy to get to the parts. So, closer look at it. We have a AMD 386 processor, which runs at 40 megahertz. Now, Intel didn't make a 480 or a 40 megahertz 386 chip. They only made a 33. AMD decided to go one step higher. There's a good article on the Red Hills hardware guide on these on the AMD 386 DX40. I'll probably post that in the description, the link to that. To that website, so you can read about. Plus, there's a lot of other really neat information on a lot of vintage hardware, and really brings back memories for me. You can also see the 387 socket, which was the numeric processor that went with the 386. I'm still on the lookout for one of those, but they're kind of hard to find. The 40 megahertz versions, a lot of them are 25 and 33 that I see. This board also had provisions for a 486. As you can see the socket there, these were known as 3486s or 786s, because you could either run a 386 with a 387, or you could pop in a 486 chip. I decided to leave it as a 386 because I've got a lot of 486 stuff laying around, and I just always liked the old 386 processors, the DX versions. Again, a lot of nostalgia, and just keep going. Strong processors, not comparable to the stuff today, but they're fun to play with. The expansion cards I have, I've got a Sound Blaster 16. This is a plug-and-play version. I thought it was an older version, but it still works fine. Then I have a Diamond Speedster Pro video card. It's got 1 MB of video memory. I think it's VRAM that it's using. It's got the Tseng Labs ET4000 chip, which this video card is very powerful for an ISA type video card. I've really am blown away at the performance this thing can kick out. Then next is the UltraStore 12F24 SD controller, which is a really, really nice controller. It supports pretty much, from what I've seen, any kind of SD drive you could throw at it. It also allows you to adjust head and cylinder SKUs. I'll have to make another video on the actual details of these hard drives and the older ST412 or MFM-RLL variants that were before the ESD standard. ESD was more of a server-based drive standard. Well, most computers of that era used the SD412 standards. And then next to that is the multi-IO card, which has the IDE port disabled, but I'm using the floppy controller and of course the IO port, serial and parallel ports. I also have, which is underneath these cables here, if I can move them around, you can get a good view of it, is there is four meg 30 pin SIMs, which give this system a total of 16 megs of memory, which is really unheard of for a 386. Most probably started out with 1 meg to 2 meg, and then later 4, and then probably at the end you may have had 8 meg of memory in them. This one I put 16 because I wanted to make it, you know, powerful, and I had the SIMs on hand, so I thought it'd be just fun to throw them in there, and the board has no trouble accepting them, so it seems to work out well. The front button and status unit right here is not original IBM AT. This actually came with a 286 10 megahertz motherboard I bought. Somebody, or the seller who was selling it on eBay, threw in this little button array and the speaker with it, and I thought, you know, this thing will fit this case perfectly, so I went and got it all wired in and hooked up, and I had to do some rewiring, and got it all neatly cabled in there, and it really works well, because it gives me not only a reset, but I also have a turbo button with the turbo LED. The original one just had a power and a hard disk status light, and then the key lock, so this one's a little more useful. This motherboard, by default, is deturboed. Originally, I just had a jumper over the where the turbo switch connector plugged in to run it at the full 40 megahertz, else it clocks down to 20, and, you know, performance suffers. I have a 320-some megabyte SD drive. It's a Priam brand. One of my earlier videos, which is long and boring, goes over actually low-level formatting a 170 meg version of this drive. They both look identical, but this one is larger. And with that SD controller, these drives actually have more than 1024 cylinders. MS-DOS can only access 1024 cylinders. So I actually was losing some of the drive. I ended up with like 270 meg. I didn't pick this up till later. But luckily the controller has translation routines in there, so it can actually present the full size of the drive to DOS. It overcomes that cylinder limit. Kind of like how the logical block addressing of the later IDE drives, you know, that were passed 504 megabytes did. So at least I was able to use the whole drive and not lose a small chunk of it. For my floppy drive, it's just a Shinin 3.5-inch high-density drive, and then I have an Irwin Magnetics 80 and 120 megabyte QIC, which stands for quarter-inch tape, tape drive. And this one just runs off the floppy controller. Now you could plug it into an add-in card, which would give it a little more performance. I think it basically allowed extra signaling, so it would send data faster over the floppy port. But I for backing up, I mean, I didn't need that much performance. I basically just, you know, would dump this drive to tape, and then if I dumped another drive in there to test it, I could just boot off a floppy disk, load the backup software, and restore it all back, and then reboot the machine, and up it would come. Makes it handy for testing. And then it's just got a, which was actually a new in the box, and I found it, AT power supply. The original one was in the case, but I felt, you know, since I found a new one, I just put that one in its place. I just haven't gotten around to testing the other one to see if it's good. I assume it probably is. It was just kind of grubby and needed to be cleaned up and stuff. So I'm going to go ahead and power this computer on. Now the CMOS battery is dead, so every time when it boots, it's going to lose all its settings, so I have to go in and set those up. Alright, so now I'm going to go ahead and power up. Reach over for that switch. Hear the hard drive come to life. It's initializing the RAM, and then I get that double beep saying that my CMOS battery is low, and that basically everything needs to be reconfigured. You know, I got a display type mismatch, F1 to run the setup. So we're going to go ahead and hit F1 to run the setup. And it has the AMI Color BIOS, which was really one of the best ones they put out. Later on they came out with the Win BIOS, which was all graphical, and it was just more detailed than it needed to be for a setup on a motherboard. So first thing I always do is I just load the power on defaults, which it probably already booted up into. Then I go and I load the BIOS defaults, which gives it a more optimized performance approach. Then we go into setup for the standard and go ahead and find the right keys. Trying to hold a camera and film kind of hard, so we're gonna go with set this up. So let me zoom in. It's June, it's the 22nd, and it's 2012, and then our time, it's 10 o'clock, but this is in 24 hour time, so there we go, 12 o'clock, 10, 11, 10 o'clock, so 22, 16, and we're running daylight savings. Now my SD controller, actually we define drive type 1, which is actually for the original Seagate ST412 hard drive, which is a 10 meg drive, but the controller just needs it so it can just bootstrap the system. The SD controller has its own BIOS and handles all the disk routines itself. So this is basically just to allow it to bootstrap and nothing more. And then we set this to a 1.44 meg 3.5. Set my display. And then we can escape out of here. Go into advanced. I normally will set the above 1 meg on because these full height drives take a while to spin up, and that gives it a nice nice delay to let the disk spin up. And then I'll turn the F1 on for errors in case like a piece of hardware decides to blow up. Being a 386, no internal cache memory. I have 128K of cache on the motherboard, which originally it had 64K, but I thought, you know, I'd upgrade it a little bit, give it a little extra. And as for the shadowing, this all looks good. So then I'm gonna go out of here, we'll go into our chipset, And on this screen, these numbers indicate basically your CPU clock, and then you're dividing by whatever number to give you your, to basically set your ISA clock speed, which is 8 megahertz. 2 would be for a 20 megahertz processor, 3 is for a 25, 4 is for a 33, 5 for a 40, and then 6 would be for a 50. Given that this is a 486 board, you could plug a 486DX50, not a DX2, but a DX50. Those are a whole different animal themselves. I may have to do a vid on one of those later on, as I do have one of those laying around. So we're going to go ahead, since we're running 40 megahertz, we're going to set this to 5. Leave the IO command recovery control off, because my cards seem to be fine. They don't have any issue where they need additional wait states. We're not running a 486, so we're going to leave that to 0, and I'm going to make the Shadow RAM cacheable, so I will get a performance boost in that regard. And then we go down here and we write these settings, and we will boot the system. And here we go. We're going to save it. We're going to hit yes, and we should see the floppy drive initialize. May have missed that already. You can see my lights are on, and we're booting into DOS, which looks not all too unfamiliar of a classic 386. And the these Priam ESD drives are pretty noisy, as you can hear. Now, I did load Win31 on this, because, you know, with 16 megs of RAM and a 40 megahertz 386, Windows is going to run, 31's going to run pretty decent. So we'll go ahead and load into there, so you can see it come up. Camera's focusing, is acting up again. I think the monitor refresh tends to throw that off a little bit. I had to throw it into manual focus for the CMOS setup part, because it was just not wanting to play nice. And we'll zoom in, and you can see some of the software I've got on here. Mainly, I put After Dark on, because that's, you know, it's a neat screensaver. It's fun to play with. And I've got WordPerfect, my Sound Blaster software, and then the Maxis, which is the old Sim games. I think that was Sim Tower I actually loaded on this one, but it doesn't run the greatest on a 386. That was written more for a 486. And I am running in 256 colors, and I think I'm at 800 by 600 for the resolution. 1 meg of RAM, it really doesn't go any higher than that. And then you tend to lose refresh rates and all that. So we'll go ahead and drop out of Windows. Get this thing back to DOS. I'm going to go ahead and load up a diagnostic program. This one's pretty neat. It tells you a good a bit about your computer. This came with an old computer book I had, and I've always liked some of the software that was on it. And as you can see, you know, 386 processor, which is 32-bit. We'll go to the next page. I have no coprocessor installed. It's something I'm looking for, but you know, they're kind of hard to find at this speed. This shows my VGA adapter and like the modes it supports. Pretty much just standard VGA, but this is actually an SVGA, so it does a little more. Serial ports too. Found a mouse. One parallel port, and then, you know, keyboard, monitor, game ports present, and CMOS is present. Interesting that's on there, but that's because the old XT class, PC and XT class systems actually didn't have CMOSes. They were just, you basically, if you wanted a to set the settings, you had to play around with a bunch of DIP switches, and if you wanted a clock, you had to throw in a real-time clock card with its own battery backup. But I'll probably discuss that in a separate video. I've got an old vintage IBM 5150, which was one of the first IBM PCs made, which is one of my latest restorations. Actually, it's was a fun project, but that'll be a different video. Here it's running some information on the disk, showing, you know, subdirectories, hidden directories, and just, you know, file information stuff. Nothing exciting. This one's showing the volume information, you know, how much I've used, and, you know, I'm seeing the full 330 meg, I've got 229 meg free, and I've used the 108 meg. And then it just shows some more data. Nothing exciting. MS-DOS version doesn't even show up because I'm running DOS 6, and yeah, it says it has Windows 3.1 on it, and my AMI BIOS state. More summary, funny how it reports version 6.16, but it's really 6.22. And then my my memory, oh, that must be the DOS memory driver, that's probably what that is. Which, you know, I've got a good amount of memory. Runs a benchmark. It's actually seeding basically the baselines, which one is your classic IBM XT, which was the 5160, which is basically the same as 5150, but it had a little bit of enhancements, but they were pretty much the same speed. Then your 280s, your AT, which is, oddly enough, is what this case is, which was an 8 megahertz. The first one's actually ran at 6, but, you know, this is a big jump over an 8088, and then the Compaq 386, and then this computer, which, given I'm running at 40 megahertz, my bus speed's higher, my processor speed's higher, so I'm definitely ahead of the game. This benchmark here would be my my hard disk. Now it's going to be off because I've actually got Smart Drive running, and that can throw off the raw disk performance because it's actually doing file caching into the system RAM, which gives you an incredible boost in performance compared to, yeah, just running off the drive itself. I normally would set the cache levels to 512K. You can go much higher on a, you know, with 60 megs of memory. I mean, on a 386, you could probably set that to like 4 meg and not even notice it, but this software tends to have kind of a hard time when you set that to higher than 512, and it may have actually crashed the program. because the drive light is not on and I'm just stuck in a please wait. So we will try to exit out. Yep, we're locked up. So I'm gonna go ahead and hit that nice reset. And here we can see it counting up its memory, and since we're already up and running with the disk, I'll just go ahead and bypass that, you know, since waiting for it to count all 16 megs. And normally, you know, it would say 16384, but 384 meg of that memory is reserve memory for ROM space and upper memory and, you know, special areas, so it really doesn't show up on the memory test because it's not getting used by the system. Yeah, see, I've got smart drive set for 2 meg, so what I need to do is hit the reset again, and we are going to load this thing, basically bypass the auto exec and config sys from loading, or config sys and auto exec, because that's the right order they load in. And now I should be able to try to type with one hand and hold the camera with the other. One of these days I'll have to get a better camcorder. I'm using an older VHS-C camcorder. I had one that would have probably give better video because it ties directly into this old VCR I have, and I wouldn't have to use a tape. I could just plug the feed right into my Dazzle, which is what I use to digitize, but that camera is a beast, and if you want your arm to start hurting, yeah. Better if you had a tripod for that one. So we're going to go ahead and load this again. And since when we've already gone through all this, I'm going to load up the benchmarks. And we'll do the main board test again. It actually tests a little faster, even just booting straight into DOS with no memory drivers or anything. And this software is, you know, it kind of, the tolerances aren't that close. You get different results half the time when you rerun the tests. So here's my disk check. Or disk test running. Yeah, it's benchmarking it. You can probably hear the hard drive in the background crunching away. 8-platter drive. Yeah, it's got a heavy voice coil actuator, so they tend to be a little noisier, and I am getting a whopping 1.7 megabytes of disk throughput, which back in the day, that was a lot. The old MFM drives were only capable of 5 megabits. Now these are all in bytes, so, you know, your translation, yeah, it's gonna be different, but you're looking at 5 megabits for your old MFMs, 7.5 for your RLs. Well, SD, you know, you can get up to 20 megabits easily with those controllers. I mean, they were way more advanced. But, you know, for a 386, especially when you've got smart drive load, I mean, this drive really does well. I'm sure I've got some, you know, IDE drives from that era, you know, that would be, you know, be faster, and it's usually due to smaller form factors with higher aerial density. These old drives, I mean, they all spun at 3600 RPM, and, you know, when you've got a full height, 5.25-inch full height drive with 8 platters, you know, those rotational speeds, you're gonna lose some performance, plus the, they use RLL encoding. I think this one was like 36 sectors of track. Well, that's 36 sectors on the inner tracks versus the outer tracks, whereas the later drives, you had more sectors on your outer tracks because you had more surface area. That's like a whole other video I probably should do one day on all these different drive technologies. I mean, I could go on and on about that. And then our next page is our video performance, and this is where you really see the power of that T-Sing Labs ET4000 chip. Their baseline is that same card on a 486. And my 386 is well exceeding that. So I am definitely getting some good throughput. I've actually been tempted to stick this card in a 486 and see what it could really do, since a 486 is, you know, really, you're pretty much doubling your performance of a 386. I think I read somewhere that a DX40, a 386 DX40 is like the same speed as a 486 DX20. So, I mean, if you've got a 486 DX33 or like a DX266, I mean, you could imagine, you know, you're going to see some increase in performance. Now, those systems, you know, normally have Visa Local Bus, or in the later versions, PCI, you know, where the system's just all straight ISA. I mean, the video card's still clocking at 8 megahertz, where VLB, you know, you're running your card at the same speed as the processor, and PCI, it was fixed at 33 megahertz, because by then, you know, Pentium processors were coming in, and your later 486s were, you know, your clock doubling and tripling, more or less clock tripling, but your back-end bus speed was typically, you know, 33 megahertz. But again, that's a whole nother discussion. So I'm going to go ahead and Alt-X out of this and show, and we'll have some fun here. Show you what this thing can do. Try to hold the camera steady here, and I actually loaded Doom on this. Now I have to run it in the low resolution sprite mode, because the 386 processor just does not have the power. Even with that powerful video card, it still just can't do it. But in low sprite mode, it runs pretty decent, given what it's on. Now, if I flip this into high sprite mode, you can see that it's a lot more choppy. Not bad, but it's pretty choppy, whereas in low sprite mode, I mean, you could actually, you know, play this game, and, you know, it definitely is working pretty good, especially for something, you know, as classic as this, you know, compared to, like, Doom was really written for a 486 DX33, you know, with a really decent video card. I've got another system that's got that same chipset card, ISA, and, you know, on a 486 DX30, I mean, it runs just really smooth in high sprite mode. So we'll go, one more utility we can take a look at here. Yes, put this thing to DOS. It's interesting to load that on there, on the version that was the Ultimate Doom, and that's on a, CD-ROM, but, you know, that was back in the day, I guess, when CD-ROMs were just coming in, so the install files were actually in floppy format. So you could actually, you know, copy them over to floppy disk and install the game, which is really handy. It used the old D-ICE program, which, you know, anybody that remembers 486s and Doom and all that, you know, they're probably familiar with, and you know, you could just basically copy your installer on disk one with the first de-ice file, and then your remainder disks, you just copied the single de-ice file, and it would just prompt you for, you know, disk one, disk two, disk three, disk four, you know, and so on, and then it would ask for disk one back, and then it would basically extract that, and then you could load your game and run it. Nowadays, you know, everything's starting, you know, it's coming out on DVDs, and probably not too long in the future, everything will probably be on Blu-ray, with these multi-terabyte drives and everything. So we're going to go back to that diagnostic software suite that I had, and we're going to go into the sys, I think it's the cache directory, which for some reason they put a real nice, you know, informational program in here. I think it's syscheck. Yeah, this is a good. I like it because it really tells you the your actual system, you know, what's running on it, and you know, I'm running at 40 now. If I go back here, let that camera focus, and I deturbo this thing, and I come back here. Now let's say I go down to processor, and then back up. Notice how it says 20? Yeah, turbo switch, when you disengage that, it cuts the CPU down in half, which really that was something from the Turbo XT days when you had 8088s and 8086s running at, you know, 8 to 12 megahertz, and your programs that were written for the old 4.77 megahertz, you know, they didn't have any routines written in there to keep them at the same speed, so the faster your processor ran, the faster the program ran, which typically affected games of most things. And you know, I always hear old computer guys, you know, talking about that and how they would, you know, get a kick out of like these games running faster, and they master it, and then their friends, they challenge them, they'd have such a hard time because they'd be used to a slower clock speed on the processor. You know, this just gives more information, you know, on the CPU. Again, yeah, I don't have the coprocessor enabled. I don't have the broken 386. I can run 32-bit code on that. Well, this is an AMD chip anyway. Intel's, the very first 386, some of them were broken and actually were stamped on them 16-bit software only, so it was pretty much just a fast 286. And what I like about this is it has the speed thing. I always get a kick out of this because it actually says my throughput speed is 66 megahertz. This board, the motherboard in this computer, I'm really impressed by it. I mean, it's really fast. It's a, you know, with the 128K of cache. It has a 4X chipset on there. I wouldn't be surprised if the memory's running at zero wait states. I mean, just to get good throughput like this. I mean, I've had boards, you know, that were the rated speed, and they just didn't run good. But yeah, this is a really nice, nice system. You know, I've had a lot of fun with it. Yeah, and my VGA, nothing special about that, no network. That probably would have been Novell back in the day. Yeah, and then my hard disk, and as you can see, you know, tracks, which would be your cylinders, has been truncated down. I mean, it should be, I think, 1280, and the controller is actually translating that out. It's, what it's doing is, it's looks like it's halving the cylinders, and it's doubled the sector count. So it's doing like a crude translation. It's tricking the operating system into thinking that I have a drive with 654 cylinders with 63 sectors, whereas it really should be like 1280 or 1224. I can't remember what the count was offhand, but it had definitely had 36 sectors. Kind of interesting that controller also can, if you had a drive that was, you know, over 500 meg, it could do some translation that way, so you could have, like, larger hard drives that, basically had 1024 cylinders with 16 heads and I think it was 63 sectors. I mean, that was the limit of the older AT BIOSes before enhanced IDE, you know, and logical block addressing, you know, was integrated into the BIOSes. So the controller could actually trick things up, and you could actually get these larger drives to run. I mean, for, you know, ESD was an 80s, they're like probably very early 90s technology. I mean, it was made for servers, and I mean, this is very advanced. ESD drives are one of my favorite hard drive technologies, and that's where my YouTube username is actually formed from. Is basically ESD for the enhanced small device interface, and then the year I was born, 80. So I'm gonna go ahead and escape out of that, and I think I've pretty much shown all the details of this 386. And with the ESD drives, they use the same cable set as the ST412, the older drives. But one of the advantages, too, of the ESD drive is all these old drives, you know, every hard drive, when it, you know, when they coat that magnetic coating on there, they usually have defects. Well, the old ST412 drives are MFM and RLL drives. You actually had there was a little sticker on it that had every defect on the drive, and it was cylinder, head, and then your byte offset for that specific sector. And you had to enter all those in when you did your low-level format. Well, the ESD drives, there's a little file that's on the firmware of the logic board. It's either there, or it may be on the there's a dedicated, basically with these old voice coil drives, half of a platter actually was used for the positioning info, and that file may reside there too, but it would actually feed the defect list into the controller, so you didn't have to enter all those in, but like, unlike the older drives, you had to put all those in by hand. And then with the, as they started, you know, IDE came out, they were basically taking that controller card here and just gluing it, you know, to the bottom of the hard drive. And then they started, you know, you didn't have the low-level format, and then they do sector, you know, remapping and have spare sectors on the disk. And that's how your drives, you know, today, you know, they show up as, you know, error-free. And I can actually pull this up. If I pull up Norton Disk Doctor, whoops, that's right, I gotta reboot it. We'll give it the three-fingered salute this time, which that way I'm not stuck running the memory test, and of course I can just hit escape on it. And, you know, we're all good there. So I'll let this thing boot up again. And here you can see, you know, 128K of cash, which you know, for a 386, that's a lot. Usually 486s, like the later versions were coming with 128 and, you know, and then later 256. And then once you got into your DX4s, you know, you were putting, you know, 512 on those things. So, we'll go ahead and we'll load this up and get a nice layout of the drive. Hopefully, camcorder's saying my battery's about to die, so hopefully it'll, it'll hold up and I won't get cut short. So we'll know what happens if I get cut short. Will the battery last? And then I begin test, and all those blocks there marked with a B are your bad sectors. And on these old drives, that was normal. And this, the controller I have, can actually do sector remapping. It does have that, but I didn't do it because you do lose some of your capacity because it basically reserves a, you know, part of the disk. And, well, hope you enjoyed the video. Over and out.